Good evening. Hopefully everybody is okay. I've had a real long day. Last minute I had to get ready, so hopefully everybody can hear me and everything is going okay. Give me just a second here to make sure everything is on up and up. Sorry, folks. Just want to make sure I haven't missed any clicks or anything I should have done. So it looks like we are good, straight to go. Again, hopefully everybody is okay. Let me just shut off a couple things that I don't need running. Sorry, I know I shouldn't be doing this the last second like this, but unfortunately that's been my day. And I think we're good to go. So today's topic is going to be on the summer slowdown. I've gotten a lot of messages on sales that have been tanking for a lot of folks. Before we go into the sales aspect, this time of the year, right the second and going on through the rest of summer, is the best time to buy merchandise. That should be a huge push for a lot of people. We buy in the summer when it's cheaper. There's more of it available right now. The prices go down. This is when you need to buy. So if you want to set yourself up for the winter and next year, this is what you got to do right now. That's the biggest thing I would say, is acquiring merchandise now. Again, when it's cheap is when I buy. If it's in bulk, it's even better. There's a lot of big auctions and sales going around right this second, pretty much almost anywhere you're at, I would imagine, from what I see. And again, I do look at stuff like that fairly often. People do send me stuff all the time. I know there's a bunch of auctions going on, even just in my area. There's tons of garage sales and things like that. So again, price is cheap. That's when you buy everything. We stock up. Well, right now I really don't need to buy much inventory, but we stock up pretty much every single chance we get in the summer months. Winter months, I try to never buy unless it's just such a great deal. Winter months around here, it's obvious there's snow on the ground, temperature's cold, there's no garage sales, hardly any whatsoever, estate sales or anything like that. You may still catch some into October here and there, but that's about it. And then you go into even the auction houses, they're not very well heated in some of the cases around here. They're just big, huge barns. So in the winter months, I don't try to buy anything. And that's like one of the biggest keys to me getting stuff cheap. I don't buy it in season. I don't buy it when prices top dollar. Winter prices are going to go up. So once we hit into winter, all the merchandise prices, as a general rule, go up to some extent across most boards. Collectibles and stuff may be a little different there because the prices stay pretty steady across the board. So do sales for the most part as well. Now, the biggest thing for those who are new into, we'll call out some names and stuff in just a minute here. The biggest thing into going into summer is checking your inventory, checking what you have up right this second. Many items, if they're households or things like that, or even clothing in general, you may still have a bunch of winter items up there. And I always hear the comment that, you know, it's winter somewhere all the time. Selling like a jacket overseas, a $30 jacket or a $40 jacket overseas for 30 or 40 bucks in shipping, it doesn't work very well. Let's just put it that way. I've sold clothing for a while. We did dump it all off, as I said many times. Household stuff, though, this time of year, I think this will probably be the worst slowdown for households and clothing, again, in my opinion, based on what I see going on. The pandemic's weighing. There's a lot of new things that you can go and do outside. A lot of people have been tied up and cooped up inside. So I think there will be probably a more of a glut in purchases for a lot of everyday items. I honestly think that for those who can afford it, they'll probably want to go out and buy it as opposed to buying it online. I know there will be always a bunch that will specifically want to buy something online, but I really think that it could be a pretty bad season for some. Not ever that I would wish that, but that's just my take on it. As eBay and some of the other sites morph and change along too, it gets to be a little risky to sell certain things going forward, especially like in the summer and things like that. If say like MGM Studios being bought out by Amazon and stuff, that could vero a whole bunch of stuff. Nike's moving into reselling their own shoes. That could go into veros on eBay. It could go into a lot of things. I'm not trying to say the sky's falling or everybody panic, but these are always things that could happen. Anybody, in fact, I was talking to Mr. Magazine and Paperguy, Dave and Chuck, the other day. We talked for quite some time on a private chat, and we talked about some of these issues, obviously, as well, too. eBay could come in and clamp the door down. Amazon can clamp the door down, and they do it constantly. There's a constant trickle of things showing up on your health tab in Amazon. If you don't watch that, it gets you some dings. And a lot of it's new items that are being gated as the companies take more control over who can sell and on what platform they can sell certain things on. Now, I know people say, you know, that can't happen on eBay. eBay's never going to do it. The trend that I see is a similar trend like Amazon and Walmart have taken. And, of course, we know that quite a few of the people working at eBay now, including the person running it, is a Walmart person. So we've got to... Everybody should take that into heart and consider expanding out into categories that won't have the availability of getting gated or vero'd. And I know that sounds crazy to think about it now, and maybe you're doing great in clothing, but you should honestly consider that, especially if you're like a full-time shoe seller or something like that. You're locking your entire future of, nothing wrong with selling shoes, don't get me wrong, I love shoes too. I'm very specific on the kinds I can wear, so Rockports I pretty much try to get all the time, but you know, there's always a risk at selling stuff like that. Even like t-shirts, I had somebody send me a whole bunch of t-shirt things that were all tagged and locked out on because of the brand filed and got a vero on them for it. So there's a lot of things that can do that. I know this goes into summer. This goes into summer slowdown in the whole works too, because you've got a perfect opportunity now to diversify where the merchandise is going to be cheaper now than it will be later on. You know, not putting all your eggs in one basket. That's another reason why summer doesn't really hurt us. My sales overall are about the same all year round. No exaggeration. They may move or go from one type of item to another type of item. I think I better check to make sure everybody can hear me. I would imagine somebody would be saying otherwise. Yeah, I don't see anybody saying so. I'm assuming everybody can hear me. I know I'm terrible on looking at that sometimes, but the point of it is, though, that I've been preaching to diversify your stores to everybody, and that's what I personally did, and we've been doing. We pretty much branch out. I get new items. I get new bulk things. I figure out new things that I can sell. Clothing I used to sell. I had a lot of it. I still have a few pieces here and there, like NOS sealed, you know, vintage clothing, 60s, 70s. I have a few trucker hats, and I've got a few things like that. I have leather jackets I got a whole bunch of, but I keep most of the ones that fit me. The point of it is, though, until I fully gave up, you know, those flooded category items and clothing and stuff that around here you just can't get. Once I gave it up, my revenue changed. And I'm not preaching that to give you some fantasy world. That's the truth. My revenue changed when I was able to sort and center in on things that don't wane or slow down in certain times of the year. Certain times of the year, certain things sell better. When it gets hot out, there's some people that collect certain things that live down south, demographic wise, and they'll be inside, you know, sourcing things. So what's hot in collectibles does change slightly. What's hot in a lot of items changes, just like the clothing aspect too. But if you're not looking at it from a broad range of items, you've only got a couple hundred items up, they're all centered in on more like long jeans, tennis shoes, coats, button-down, full, you know, long-sleeve shirts and things like that, which a lot of people do have. I look at stores all the time. You're locking yourself in for slow sales, for in my opinion. You've got to diversify every aspect of your business, as other companies have done. Amazon's a different story, obviously. Number two in the reselling world is Shopify. They're a different story, too. There's more movement going on and things, and that's part of what I talked to Mr. Mag and Dave and Chuck with the other day too. The markets are changing right now, and looking ahead to what's going to happen in the future. Again, I'm just shooting this out there because ThredUp, a lot of companies are going to be taking a chunk of what used to only be people like us, a chunk of the business for them, and ThredUp has gotten really big. I've actually had a couple people tell me who were resellers tell me that ThredUp bought them out, or they were able to sell their stuff to ThredUp at some point. I don't know the whole logistics on it or anything else like that. So it's a little troublesome that, you know, they've seen what could happen. They've seen the money. They can see sales and things like that. This all affects you looking forward. Right now in summertime, if you haven't switched over, or you're still selling the same things and your sales are dying off, without rushing to slam up a bunch of new stuff, it's almost too late at this point to get a steady increase going through a summer run. It's just not possible for a lot of people because of these factors. I'm always looking ahead for next year and the year after that. I've already got plans. I've already been reaching out to some people here, some other channels, some other long and larger sellers for some of the future things that I've got in the works. There's a lot of stuff and a lot of opportunity still, even in areas that are flooded. But again, you've got to be smart and you have to diversify. I talk about other platforms and things like that, and I've looked or tried pretty much anything you can do to sell on. Some things are great, some things are not. In fact, I was talking with Dave and Chuck, and he had brought up Ruby Lane. I've looked into Ruby Lane, and you never know what a company's going to do. You never know where their mind's at. Ruby Lane, in 2019, if you don't know what Ruby Lane is, it's another selling platform. Ruby Lane decided to raise money because of some other fees they would have to pay over some issues they had to deal with. They charged a 3% buyer's fee. So if somebody was going to the site and wanted to buy something, it would say $100, but at the end of the day, it would actually cost them $103. Now, it wasn't... nobody was notified, apparently, and it turned into a huge thing. The site has been plummeted by people jumping off ship and things like that. That's just one example. And I know people had been on that site for 10 plus years, and they were all bailing ship over a terrible decision. And that's why I bring this up, because, again, every company out there could have something that you're not going to be happy with. And if it's a really bad decision, or like them cutting off adults, going back to trying to get rid of classified so they can buy back more stock and up their own pocketbooks, all of this plays into you being diversified and having other items than just things that can get shut down. That's the best way I can say it. I don't sell things for the most part that I could get dinged on or that could get pulled down. And I know this may not sound like summer play, but this all goes into your whole direction of your business. People are closing down. People are bumping off here and bumping off that site and this site and that site, just worrying about what's going on. I'm not telling anybody to jump ship. I'm telling you to have backups, have a secondary source of income, have a secondary platform. Know how some other places work. Know what you can do on each site, like Discogs. I actually just did a video in my Patreon group about Discogs. With Discogs, you don't have to have a photograph. You can list something on the largest record-selling platform on the planet without having to have a photo and without having to pay unless it sells. Most people haven't a clue that that's an option. Most people don't realize that Discogs dwarfs eBay in most cases on records. Even Amazon has a lot of records. You'd be surprised at how many records. And there's other platforms, other smaller sites. There's other auction houses. If I wanted to get some money on records, I could sell them to some specific sites straight out for cash. You know, there's things like that. I always have a backup. If I'm shut down in one spot, I haven't. I don't think I've ever been shut down on a site. But if I am for some reason, first off, I own my listings. And secondly, I have a backup place. I've got a secondary site. May not be as good as the first one, but if I put all efforts into another site, chances are I can beef that one up as well, too. So, you know, this is all things for summer. If you were getting ahead of it and started off like in the first quarter here, that's what you should be doing towards like the second and third month of first quarter. You should already be rolling into summer philosophy and thinking about what's going to be the hottest thing to sell right now. When winter comes along, I get all my stuff up before third quarter starts for fourth quarter. I get all my stuff up in third quarter before fourth quarter starts. I have it ready. Just like this time, it's June. We're almost into July. You should have already had rolled out all of your summer items and summer things and looked at your inventory again, looked at what's selling, the price structure and all. The prices do change seasonally wise. And department stores, grocery stores, brick and mortar in general, they have price resets like 3 and 4 times a year per season or per quarter. And I do that. I do that to some extent. I change up what we list, what we sell. Again, I've talked about that kind of thing before. I know it may seem redundant, but that's the best key to surviving, for those new especially, making it through a tough summer if that's what it does pan out to be, which I hope it's not, but my honest feelings are that this summer will probably be the slowest for many people for online selling. Again, people have been cooped up, haven't been able to go out, all the restrictions are going away around here, you can pretty much do whatever you want. You know, big events are going to start coming back real quickly here, and, you know, people can't wait to get out. The money's not going to be spent online as much because of that. Everybody in their right mind is going to want to get out and enjoy friends and hanging out in public and doing things. This is that, again, that's my concern, and I want to make sure everybody's aware of that. Maybe I'll be wrong, but it's slow for a lot of people in summer. I can't imagine it being busier than last summer with all what has gone on. So these are all factors to think about. Again, number one, which I said in the very beginning, this is the best time to buy. Stock up, fill your back stock, any extra space you have, with good, decent products that you can get reasonably. That's your number one thing to do in summer if you haven't set yourself up ahead of time. If you're just now, we're almost to July, and you're just now thinking sales are starting to go down, what am I going to do? Again, look towards the next year as well while it's going on. Go through your inventory, move stuff around if you have to, adjust prices if you have to. The old cliche about, you know, it's winter everywhere, somewhere, at any time of the year is true, but again, the costs are going up for people, for shipping and all this kind of stuff. There's an eBay platform, quite a few of them in Europe. There's not a lot of sense for someone to buy them from here unless they're wanting something very, very specific. eBay pushes their other platforms. There's Amazons in other places besides here too. There are other platforms in other countries. England has a couple extra ones too. There's some more in Australia. There's many more throughout Europe. France has quite a few. There's some French toy sites that are incredible. There's Japanese sites again. So the sites, and what I see is happening, is more of this is getting local. Even eBay is going after local sales. Google's going after local sales. Shopify is pushing local businesses and things. So the what's selling overseas, from my experience and from what people tell me on their sales and things, are mostly collectibles through the summer times. If it's going to sell overseas, they're not going to want to buy clothing that they can get in their country for the same price and not have to pay the shipping. And again, that's just my take on it. I try to sell things that you can sell in different countries that aren't just collected for one sole reason, because it's in this country or that country. A lot of my items, and not just on one platform, but many platforms, sell to multiple countries. I've sold to, geez, Norway, just today, Norway, Sweden, and these are two people that just bought from me a few days ago. We sent to Japan. I sent quite a few to the UK, one to Australia, two to Canada. One went through eBay's thing to Peru or something like that, too. I think it was 7 countries just today. And that's just on this platform we're talking about here. It's a big push. And I know a lot of people are hesitant to do all that kind of thing. But if you want to not have that issue going into summer, you got to be prepared for it. It's not like, hey, it's summer, I can instantly go ahead and worry about what's going on. If anybody wants to offer up where their sales are going in the feed here, we'll get to the feed right now. I'm interested to hear, again, I hear from a lot of people either way, but it'd be interesting to hear from as many as I can. I'm interested in that kind of thing. It'd be nice to know where sales are going for most people. I'm not having pretty much an issue on it whatsoever. If I'm slow on one site for a week, it usually makes it up the next week, or I sell on other sites. Yesterday I did like $100 on hip, you know, so, and that's just out of the blue. You never know what's going to happen on one site versus the other. Ruby Lane wouldn't be one I would recommend. Obviously, I wouldn't recommend Bonanza. I've heard just dismal results from pretty much everybody I have talked to. And we tried it once. It just wasn't worth the hassle. If you got a list every day on there and push and advertise and stuff, it's not passive income. Most of what we do is passive income. It means I buy a bunch, I list it up, and it sits there as long as it takes to sell. If that's 5 years, 10 years, I don't care. I don't pay a dime once it's up. It's just rolling inventory. Let's see who's in. Naomi, how are you doing? Seattle in the house. I've been through Seattle once in my life. I haven't been there a very long time. Duncan, there have been a lot of talk of slow sales on eBay, but mine are still good. However, I did find, so I was trying to sell copies of the stuff I sell. This should be banned. Not only are there people selling copies, I saw there was copied money, bills, that were printed at someone's house, both sides of them. Now, they were technically obsolete, but technically they were still redeemable for cash. I also saw postage stamps. Even though they were old, a postage stamp, even if it's 100 years old, is still legal tender or legal postage in this country. So, and eBay never took them down. I did report those because that's downright counterfeiting, you know, and that's something that I would recommend people do is report things like that. And I know people say, why would you report other people? Because at the end of the day, the only people that get hurt for us not reporting issues is us. They'll institute a new deal like the back door allowing law enforcement to come in and take our listings down. That's what happens when eBay lets it get out of control and people aren't helping out with the situation. If I work somewhere, I want to make that place the best it can be because I look better when the place looks better and they're more looked upon as being a good company. So there's no reason to not do the right thing and report issues, especially ones that are illegal. You know, but again, eBay doesn't do anything about it. That's the point. I reported something almost a week ago that was clear and blatantly copied of bills, currency, and postage stamps that were listed in those categories. And I'm sorry, that's not what those were, and that is a illegal act. It's illegal to copy something that could be used as postage. Again, because vintage stamps are still mailable. Doesn't matter if they're perforated, non-perforated, they were made in 1910. I can still stick those on a post on an envelope and mail something out with a 150-year-old stamp if I wanted to. People send me stuff sometimes, and you'll see stamps that were made 50 years ago on envelopes. I send them occasionally. We bought a huge mass assortment of postage stamps, mostly NOS stuff to resell. I bought it under 50% of face, and we were selling it at 75% of face. And I used some of it for postage. You know, it was old stamps. Who cares? Who cares if the stamp was minted in 1947, the 3 cents, whatever it was. It didn't matter. It's the point that, you know, they don't take care of that stuff. I still report it. It's I'm not going to fall on it because they're not doing the right thing. Hey, Aaron, how are you doing? I'm going to be focusing on some higher demand items like video games in coming weeks. The only thing I want to say about video games, collectors will collect them either way you go. But more people go outside, so video game sales do kind of wean a little bit as summer goes in from my personal experience. Again, it depends on the game. If they're vintage games, I pretty much can sell them most all year round. In season, winter, fourth quarter, they usually go for a little more, especially if it's a hot game or there's a resurgence in interest in it or it was something that was added to like a PlayStation store or something and somebody wants the real game. That happens too. I've seen it personally. Treasure Finder Station. Finder Station, I'm assuming that's what it is. Welcome. Hope you're doing well. Hey, Marty. Jiminy Flippit, how are you doing? I have not checked your channel out in a few days. I'll have to pop over there. Sunday Funday Pamela Saban, hello. Super hot in Arizona. It was 93 here. In my office, it is 67 in here right now. I've got an atomic clock on the wall. It's 87 outside right now at this moment. I keep it cool in here. I don't know about everybody else, but I've got a lot of electronic equipment, a lot of stuff running, and it can get hot, and I'm just one to keep it cool. Hey, Bob, how are you doing? Good evening to you. Eric Jones, how are you doing? Let me slide down here just another brief moment. The boring moments, definitely noticing a slowdown after stimulus checks stopped. Again, it depends on stimulus money from what I see was people buying clothing, games, you know, if they're younger folks, games and stuff like that. I don't think most of the stimulus went for collectibles, so to speak, but most of the people that I sell to collectible-wise, the higher-end collectibles are mostly retired or the money doesn't mean anything to them, in my opinion, from what I see, because I'd never spend $1,000 on a shirt button, but that's what people do on $500 shirt buttons and all that stuff, or $500 for a card or $500 for a comic book or $1,200 for a magazine. The people that are buying this stuff from us, and those are real prices of things I've sold recently, are people, again, that their income isn't affected by any stimulus or anything else like that. no dog. I'm not. That's no disrespect. The point of that statement is that I sell things intentionally based on the type of demographics of people that would buy them, meaning that the people that buy most of my stuff are either retired or are wealthy enough, or they don't give a hoot what's happening with the economy. And that's usually what I see. Some of it's schools, some of it's businesses, some of it's some art studios and things that will repurpose it and things like that. I still get some other companies from California and stuff that will buy hundreds of pieces of Victorian items, and they'll do a whole series of them. The last one wanted 500 of one specific type of thing, and I had it, so we did very well in that. But again, I've literally steered what I sell to things that I know I can sell no matter what, value-wise. I don't try to sell cheaper stuff, but, you know, $10 or higher is my bottom end on anything. And that $10 item I pay nothing for. I mean, I've obviously paid something, but I get my money back like the first day I start listing it, and it's cheap stuff that's always going to sell. If I'm, you know, selling stuff that's just every day, that's flooded categories, it sits. My inventory backs up and it doesn't go anywhere. If I sell smaller things that I know that those crowd of people don't care about that stuff, it works better for me. That's all I can tell you. It's true. That's exactly how my business runs. You can see what I sell. It's everybody says it's odd or crazy or I never see that. Well, I've taken time to find it. And I would say the same thing 10 years ago, 15 years ago, that most people say when they say, how the heck can you do that? I target things, I spend my time doing it, and I figured out what sells all year round. End of story. I mean, if targeted sourcing means that I go out and figure out things, I go through Google Trends, I look up what's hot certain times of the year, I look up where those items may have been manufactured, where they may have been stored, where businesses are that have been abandoned and things like that, and that's how I get some major good goodies. I don't go out and source like everybody else. You don't see me doing the garage sale haul videos like all the channels do. I'd rather show you and talk about how to get the stuff, how to do the stuff, and what's valuable than showing you me finding something. I personally used to like watching those, but these days there's 100 channels that do that, and I like to learn something. If I'm not going to learn something, I don't like to watch it. If I'm going to just watch videos of people hopping around from a place, I'm not learning how to get it. I'm just learning that if you go to garage sales, you may find something. And to me, that's not helpful. I know that may not be the answer some people like to hear, and I don't mean any disrespect to other channels, but the folks that are dying off, you need the information. You need to dig into new different items and venues and spend your time watching things that are going to help you learn something. Anybody can look up something on their phone, whether at a garage sale or flea market. That's all I would like to say. You need to be able to judge stuff without looking stuff up. You need to be quicker than the other person. You need to be able to determine a targeted place to go where you're going to go and get something, where you're not going to have to randomly drive around. Again, I love garage sales. Don't get me wrong. I love flea markets. I love all that stuff, but I lose so much time in driving and hoping to find something. Again, it's out there. If you've got good opportunities out there, you need to be doing that all the time. But again, it's a lot of time involved in that. I've switched to things, and that's always a recommendation, to switch to things that don't die off, that don't rely on paycheck to paycheck for the most part, or extra money that they might happen to have, or gift money or something else like that. You want demographics of people that will always be able to buy from you, and then you need to double down on those items that you figured out. Fishing, here's a perfect example that's everyday items that you can find. Fishing tackle. Vintage fishing tackle. If you get old or good items, it doesn't matter if it's in season or out of season, it is going to sell. It doesn't matter. The high-end collectors of fishing lures don't really worry about the money. The ones that are buying a $500 fishing lure, a $1,000 fishing lure, don't care about the money. If somebody's buying a $10,000 record, they don't care about the money. It's not that. Again, I don't care who buys from me. I want everybody to want to buy something from me. But the point is I look into the ones that I know would spend the top dollar first. Corporate America does it. You should take some of these things that they do. This is part of the reason I don't slow down like everybody else does in summer. I've got multiple sources of revenue streams coming in. So if one thing dies again, I've got something else to rely on to fill that gap in. Even if you don't have a ton to fill it in, there are other things. I've showed you can do offers to watchers. You can do a discount, a markdown and discount sale. When you do those, it also sends out notices to people who follow your store. So you're getting stuff in. The coupon will help you as well, too. I did a coupon video. I showed you how to do the eBay coupons. It's a good option. There are some flaws to it. You have to print it at the end. I'm sorry I did not put that in the video. That was my fault. I know where it is, so I didn't think about it. When you go to print, and I know some people don't do your slip. It comes and prints out with the slip. So just FYI. I didn't even think about it, but maybe you can just copy your own and scan it because the number and everything on it is the same. So you don't have to necessarily worry about that. I'll have to look into it, but I was thinking maybe there's another option to do it that way also. But these are all things that can help you. If you're paying attention and you're following your sales on a daily basis. Now we do, I do forecasts and I look at my sales. I look at them every day to see if I'm up or down for the month. The second day of the month, I can tell where I'm at. It's very easy to do, you know, sales forecasts and things like that. It'll tell you where you're at for any day of the week for the entire month. And I do it throughout the month. So on day 17, I can tell you what I'm going to do based on sales for the first 17 days for the month. And sometimes it goes up, sometimes it goes down. If you're keeping track of that, and I don't trust eBay's results. Again, I'm multiple sites, so it's a group report that I'm doing. I do something about it. If something dips and it dips for more than a few days, I'll run a little sale. I'll list a few other higher dollar items so that sale number stays steady and still goes up a little bit. 3% or higher increase is what you want even in the summer. So anyway, let's hop over here. I know I rattle off for a lot, but Eric Jones, good evening as well. Did I miss Amazon Seller 99? Hey Don, should be blame Amazon Prime Day for the slowdown? I don't think Amazon Prime Day. No, I don't think I've ever bought anything off of Amazon Prime Day. I mean, I don't need any electronics. I only buy clothing when I need them. I don't really care what, you know, I buy them when they're cheap, obviously. But I don't think I've ever bought anything on a Prime Day. I don't need a TV or a PC or a phone or anything like that. Hot Arizona, lucky it is only 101 here today, and we're at 42,000 or 4,200 feet in the mountains. Wow. Must be pretty there, Bob. Hudson Resale, how are you doing? Good evening. Black Crystal Dice, back at you. Greetings to you. Big Rex, how are you doing? Over 100 degrees here, too. Jeff Loftus, hello. Joe Samard, how are you doing? Good afternoon. You must be somewhere towards the West Coast. Joe the Breadman Reseller Channel, how are you doing? Some of the right things is key. Quit selling used toasters from yard sales. Yeah, the toaster is $15. Unless it's a vintage one, I wouldn't mess with stuff like that. There are some Tupperware I've always done good in if when we were doing garage sales a lot. Again, I haven't been to a garage sale in forever. I did go to one not too long ago just because it was like on my way to the grocery store. But other than that, I usually don't do it. I ran into a thrift store the other day only because I was dropping stuff off and I wanted to get my donation slip for tax purposes. So again, if you donate something, get a slip, write it down, get a note, and itemize your taxes if you're a business and use that as a deduction. You can declare the loss and mark that part off on your taxes, just FYI. Again, it depends on your business and how you do it, but for the most part, you can do that. Duncan, I'm going in to manage payments next week. Do they charge a transaction fee on every payout? It's not like that. You're paying it might be different in your country. I'm not really sure. I would probably read over, but it's not like that. There's like a 30 cent. It's just like when you're on PayPal, 30 cent, and then their overall fee. There's no extra fee besides that. I guess that's the point of my comment. Hey, Annie, how are you doing? Another fellow YouTube channel member, channel owner. She has her own channel, too. Just like Marty, Jiminy, flip it up there. Shelly Middlebrook, how are you doing? Galveston. My wife's got family in Galveston. In fact, my niece, I got a niece in there. She's got a little adorable baby. My wife sent her something the other day. Catherine Sampson, hi Don, my sales are decent but lower. Having fun shopping yard sales, thrift shops, estates, etc. Now that COVID regulations gone in Massachusetts. Let me, I have fun doing that too. I know it's great fun and everything like that, but in all honesty, once I love doing that stuff, even if I'm not going to sell it. That I love doing it. But for business-wise, there's better opportunities, or at least around here. I don't know what it is in everybody's place, but I know a lot of other people have been coming to the same conclusion. Aaron, not the Aaron that I just hollered out to, but I have another Aaron in my group, and he's caught on to what I do literally to the T, and we've been conversing back and forth quite heavily, actually. And he's picked up on it, and his sales are still, he's 30% up. So, I mean, it's totally doable if you're doing it right. But he's targeting very specific items. And I'm telling you, believe it or not, that's the key to doing good. Not just surviving, but doing good through the summer. I think this summer is going to make it or break it for a lot of people. And I always hate to say that, but I hear it. I hear it. I hear people doing this and doing that, and people reaching out to me when they're in dire need and things like that. And this one's going to make or break some people, I'm telling you. You know, we had some really horrendous months, you know, when we first started this full time. And I know the feeling. You know, you want to just give up or take a job if you have to. That your call. I would never tell somebody to go against their personal feelings or thoughts on the matter. But if you can hang on, you can dig in and learn something else besides what you know right now, you're going to do better. The folks that do the same thing year after year, eventually you're going to, you know, not be able to do that. There'll either be more competition, less opportunity to sell it. There'll be zeros. And again, it's summertime. You've got to have all this down before you roll in the summer. Overall, pretty much most everybody that's telling me is having a slower time. Duncan, there's collectible people that don't see it as much. We can do things. I hold on to some higher dollar stuff. I don't sell a lot of stuff most of the time. I got like 15 pounds of Civil War buttons. I haven't listed a single one. I've had them for over a year. They're all extras too. You know, I'm not in the need. If I have a slow period, I can throw up a couple dozen, get myself a few thousand bucks for those couple dozen buttons, and big deal. I've got posters, all that stuff, and that all plays into me targeting. Again, targeting. Again, if your only source is driving around in garage sales and stuff, that's great. But if I had to do that around here, I'd be living on the street. And I'm not just saying that, and I'm talking a three-state area. Yeah, I can do the flea markets. I can do all that stuff and still make okay, but I'm not making as much money when I do that. Unless I'm targeting, I'm not making all, because it's hit or miss. It's hit or miss, and I don't like hit or miss. I still do occasionally go to flea market, sometimes to talk to people I know, see what's there, maybe do a video. But again, that's not my choice at all. I would rather just get the stuff, come back, and list it. I don't want to do the random driving around. Again, it's not a criticism towards anybody. That's what I did for years and years and years and years. But if you can get a way to get the stuff, whether it's a wholesale, a bulk deal, RA mass purchase, auction house where you're buying 400 or 500 items at once, Craigslist ad, Facebook Marketplace ad that's got 10,000 records for sale, or 10,000 books or 10,000 magazines. A business closing down is excellent, super, super good. Every time we've bought down an entire business, I have just raked in more money than I could think about. I mean, in the last big business we bought, oh my gosh, like 5,000 first edition dust jacketed books going back to the 50s and even before, real good ones. The Talbot Odyssey was one that I was always wanting to get one, and I finally got a Talbot Odyssey, and that's a very expensive book, even if it's a markdown book. So, I mean, there's a lot of things like that. That's the deals you need to find. You need to find the old drive-in theater that's now up for auction, all their equipment's in there, and they've got films and posters sitting in the back. You need to find the old malls that are closed down that may have stores in there. You need to find closed down, full-fledged businesses that closed the door, just left everything in there. Those are some of the best, and I know, well, how are you going to find those? And those aren't around, and I'm just going to tell you they are, because I find stuff that way all the time. And I'm nothing special. There's no big secret to it. Anybody can dig in enough and figure out where to find stuff like that at. I get people asking me all the time, where do you find this? How do you get that? And what's your secret? I've spent a lot of time doing it. I've invested my time into figuring out where I can get stuff. So while people are randomly driving around and spending 40 hours a week just to find stuff, I may spend 10 or 15 hours looking for stuff, and then 2 hours getting it, and then I have all that extra time to list it. That's the key to it. And again, it just takes you time. If you're just starting off, it's just going to take you time to get to that point. There's no other difference. It's all about time and how much effort you put into it. Nobody gave me a clue or showed me how to get to somewhere. I never watched YouTube videos or anything else like that. Trial and error, a lot of investigating, a lot of researching. I lost a lot of time in the beginning doing it, and that's why a lot of people don't do it, and that's why I can afford to give this information out, because most people won't give up all that extra time. They'll just say, well, I'm not buying anything. I'm losing time researching. You know, eventually you might be running a business because there's too much competition, too many big businesses are getting into your markets and stuff like that, and you're not going to know anything else. You know, learn a little bit each time you can. Pick an item, something different. Learn it 1 week. You know, take a couple weeks if it takes that long to do it. Go out and see what you can find. Easy, low-lying fruit like postcards are always easy enough to at least get into enough where you can kind of get the start of it. Any category you're going into is going to have to take time to understand it. There's just no other way around it. Obviously, like clothing, anybody can look up a Levi's size 28 men's boot cut jeans. Anybody can find out a price for that. It's the other items that you're going to do far better at, because most people don't take the time to do it. Again, it all goes back to there's too many people that aren't willing to invest the time and energy into figuring this stuff out. And if you're going to be the one that does it, you're going to give up some time in the beginning. A year from now, though, you're going to be the guy that's snaking everybody else out of those sales, because you're going to know more than them. If you don't take the time to do it, you're never going to get to that point. Most people, unless they're taking that time, aren't going to get to a point to be able to do the numbers that we do or other big sellers or other big channels do. It's just not. Most channels, most other resellers that are big have branched out and figured out ways to get bulk. Bulk, that's always the case. It's always wholesale or big lots or things that they can refresh or replenish. Passive income is the best way to do anything. Passive income. I can say that to them blue in the face, and people still won't do it again. That's why I can give information out, because so many people aren't going to follow through with it. They won't comprehend it. They don't want to spend the extra time, the effort. They'll stick to what works for them right now, and then wonder in 2 years or a year when things start to die off, what are they going to do? You've got to do it ahead of time. Always be proactive. Always be looking at next year, not just this year. If you're not looking ahead, just making it through a summer isn't going to get you much place, because you didn't get your stuff, your ducks in a row, to be able to handle fourth quarter. You know, we're already looking at fourth quarter at this point. Fourth quarter is not that far away when you want to be ready at the midway of the year part on your whole plan. Again, for like RA and FBA and stuff like that, you should have bought that last October for this coming up fourth quarter. October. So this October, you're buying for next year. Next year's Christmas, if you're smart and if you're able to wheel and deal. That's the rule. So again, my summer was already taken care of at the end of last year. I've already got everything decided on what we're doing for summer, to if we get slow periods, if certain items are dying down. I already know what I'm doing. I already got material that will sell through the entire summer that won't kill my sales. So again, that's what you got to do. We're working towards next summer right now. That's what you're looking at. You do what you got to do this summer, but you darn well better start getting your ducks in a row for fourth quarter come August, end of August. You need to darn well better be getting your stuff ready, getting some plans, getting some winter items up if you don't have them up. You know, that's just the game that we're play. Treat it as a game of risk. You got to be able to look ahead. You've got to be able to foresee where things could go. You've got to look on what you want to accomplish, set some goals, you know, a vision. That's always great. I'm telling you, I've got a big vision. I've got a vision statement. Whether no one else sees it or not, I know what I want to do with what's going on. I've got a ton of things. I write stuff down all the time. There's just so many things that you've got to understand when you're doing this. It's not just you're going to drive to a garage sale or a flea market or something, you're going to make it rich. It just doesn't work that way. Every time I get something that's worth a lot of money, I've sought it out. I haven't just hoped I find it. It's not like that around here. I know there's a lot of other people who are in the same boat, where thrift stores are awful, garage sales are bad, there's no real good auctions. You've got to have some other in besides that. You can't rely on stuff like that. Not up here in the winter, because all that stuff pretty much is gone. So You know, if you can survive up here in the north in the winter when everything's closed down pretty much, you should be able to work yourself into fixing the summers for yourself as well. If you're in the summer hot months, you run into similar issues. Sometimes it's too hot for people to want to run a garage sale. I see that when we live down in Mississippi and in Florida too occasionally. But again, it's cheap now. So Arizona is opposite from you guys, was 115. Wow. That was pretty bad. Hey, Carlene, how are you doing? Good evening. Michelle, good evening as well. I have a video for, people have been asking me for this for a while. I got a video on the other channel going up. You're going to see me ordering the astronaut frog image that I did for postcards. I did the whole order online. You'll get to see it. I recorded it all. You'll see where I order my postcards from, my thoughts. I scanned it. I pieced it together. I got all that stuff in a video. It should be up this weekend for the frog astronaut postcard. Again, I've got a video on this channel of me painting it if anybody's interested. I've had a lot of people bugging me. I've already sold some of the original drawings from it. I had a lot of interest. I was really kind of surprised. But that video is coming up on the other channel, just FYI. For Patreon, you got another one coming up showing some items posted. Somebody posted a little tin they paid $1 for on Patreon. There's a lot of stuff in that tin, so pay close attention to that. Look at it ahead of time before the video comes up. It'll be up by Saturday, FYI. Naomi, yeah, I know things are not looking good when Vicky's word in choosing to stay home and not travel. She feels she must list every day. Her sales are down from where they were last year, summer. That's what I see people. Most people are telling me their sales are down from last summer. Again, I'll repeat this. I know I've said it quite a few times today. This summer will probably be the worst summer for most everybody. If you were on for the last couple of years on eBay or reselling, I honestly feel this summer could be the worst. Now, if you're doing RANOS, you're possibly doing it on Amazon and even on eBay, maybe you hit some Walmart, you might do okay if you've got enough quantity of bulk RA and FBA items to send it in general. RA, retail arbitrage. And then fulfilled by Amazon FBA, if you don't know what that is. That's where you send your items in, it's stored at Amazon, and they ship them out for you. Those are usually the best because you get the buy box. Buy box is utmost important on Amazon, as everybody should know if you're on Amazon. Let me slide down. I'm going to try and get to some more comments and questions. Got plenty of time. My feed tends to bop around, so I think I just lost it here. Just a second. Hang on, I think I'm getting close to where we were. Okay, Alan Fairbanks, how are you doing? Well, thank you very kindly. Yeah, I start, today I slept into like 7:20. I think it was like 7:20 this morning. The day before it was 5:55 when I got out of bed. And that was the first part. I packed up what I could in the morning. I did a video. I got some others that I had to do because I had to send somebody some things. I ghostwrite for one site, and I also write for e-commerce bites. I also do a couple other things for a few other people these days. So I usually try and knock out that kind of stuff in the morning. I did my credits. Unfortunately, I forgot to change them for the live show, but the tomorrow's videos, you'll see the updated, all your call-outs for those who have joined Patreon. All your call-outs will be in there. I've changed the outro, the ending credits. Patreon, if you saw the introduction on the video I posted today, you'll see clouds and that kind of stuff at the end of the video, just FYI. It's simpleton. I've tried to speed up anything I could, even in the video aspect. Let's see here. I don't want to miss anybody today. Lisa, how are you doing? Good evening. Good evening. Kevin Hawthorne, good evening. Welcome. Lakeland, Florida. I used to source out in Lakeland, Florida myself. RV Butterfly Wholesale and Thrifting. How are you doing? Good evening. Naomi, yes, clothing are not it. Vintage for me, but not too much. I've gone into paper like you, along with toys. My son is selling nothing but vintage toys. I love vintage toys more than anything, honestly. Big Ultraman fan, if you can't tell. I don't go out and source that way, so I don't worry about finding the toys like I used to. I'd love to find them, but I don't even look at ads anymore for stuff for sale or anything else like that. I literally just go for the stuff that I've been swinging into. The only thing I can say about some of the toys is if I'm ever going to have a problem with getting paid on items, it's usually from younger people. And depending on the toy or the comic book or the price of it, those are usually the ones that tend not to pay right away or I have issues with. So if somebody's paying $500 and their feedback's good, they got 100% and stuff, they're going to pay me. In probably 99.9% of everything that I sell, high price is paid for right away. I don't have that luxury with some of the cheaper and the toys. Again, nothing wrong with toys because I do love toys. I've got a bunch. You've seen a haul not too long ago. I've got a ton of vintage 70s action figures. I've got a couple full cases of Star Wars vintage action figures from the 70s and 80s. I picked up a Black Hole set of figures the other day. This is from somebody I know, but I love Tron, Battlestar Galactica. I just picked up a Lucifer from the JCPenney catalog exclusive one with the dome clear head. I think his name's Lucifer, the robot, the evil emperor's robot sidekick from the TV series. Balthazar, I found two the other day. If you know, those are only JCPenney Sears exclusives. I love old toys. Where are we at? Hey, Dom, how are you doing? Hope you're doing well. I got to hit you up about another live show together with you too. Hope Dom's doing well. Again, if you don't know Primetime Treasure Hunter, I think you're really missing out a lot of good content. It's one of my favorite channels besides, you know, my content and stuff, but Dom's like me and stuff. He's pretty much straightforward and to the bone and honest. So if you haven't followed him, you don't know who he is. Dom's a real good guy. We do stuff constantly every single month, so FYI, I'm sure most everybody knows who Dom is, but if you haven't hit the like button, please hit the like button. We've got well over 200 people in house. I got 69 likes, so if you're enjoying the conversation, please hit that thumbs up button. Aren't there shorting Thread Up? I think they are trying to take them down. I don't know who's trying to take Thread Up down, but Thread Up is huge now. They've got, like, warehouses and warehouses. They've got, like, retail establishments, from what I understand, as well. I've seen a video just on their shipping facility. And, oh, my gosh, they're moving up. I'm not hoping, but I could see where big companies start working out deals with the thrift stores. So all you're going to be able to do is find clothing at, say, garage sales, and that's it. That's my concern. And, again, people may not be thinking about that, but just because it's not happening now, you got to be looking a year or two in advance. That's why your summers have to be planned out. I'm not joking. I've been looking into this stuff, and I don't sell that stuff, but I like to know what's going on. I read a lot with E-commerce Bites. I like to know what's going on. I like to know where market trends are going in general, because if a whole section of eBay starts to die off, it could hurt my business too, because not as many people would be going there. So all of that affects everybody. You just need to pay attention to it. Pamela Saban, I'm cleaning out my stock, selling off a lot of items, downsizing, going to smaller, lighter items, taking care of grandson so that where my time is now. I fully get that. Perfectly understandable. Big Rex, did you say Thread It or Thread Up? Thread Up. Catherine Sampson's got it there too. They're a monster in it. They really are. I have to say it. They could take over the whole reselling clothing world. I'm not joking. They've come from nowhere to be this massive company. Yeah, I don't drink soda, so you'll see me with juices and stuff. That's about the only sugar I have these days. NY Guy, how are you doing? Yeah, if the economy tanks, collectors will still be buying. That's a fact. When everybody else was hurt and everybody was getting laid off, I was selling $500, $1,000 items still. You know, I sold a comic book, one of the Ninja Turtle ones. I sold two of them, but I sold one that it was damaged. A year ago, I would have never been able to get even a third of what I got out of that comic book. In the worst part of the pandemic, I still got more than top dollar for things because collectors, they couldn't buy stuff. Ruby Lane is like a museum. People go there to look. There's people that have made a living off of Ruby Lane, Elisa. Until they did that 3% buyer's charge and then added on a 6.76%, I think, onto seller's fees, they lost a lot of people from that. And then the CEO of the company sent out a really condescending, rude, arrogant letter to the people selling on the platform, blaming them for what they were doing. It was awful. I've got a copy of it. I actually sent it on to a couple other folks. But I've got a copy of it if anybody wants to see it. It's a letter straight from the CEO sent out in, I think, 2020, complaining about a bunch of stuff and blaming everybody on the platform for it. And that's why Ruby Lane took a tank in the last 2 years. I would have recommended it probably before that, depending on the items you're selling. But most people are telling me these days, one told me that they're not even covering their fees. It's expensive. And you can get refused. They could say your photos are bad. They could just kick you off for no reason. And I can tell you story after story of people telling me that same thing on Ruby Lane. Matt Conlon, how are you doing? We're still here. So again, if you're enjoying the conversation, please hit that thumbs up on the video for us there. Donald's Discoveries months ago, and I'm at almost 500 listings right now on eBay. While I still work a full-time, should I already start selling on other platforms? Depends on what you got. What you're selling, I guess, would be the biggest thing. Like with HIP. And again, if you don't know what HIP is, there's three different HIP platforms. There's HIP stamps, HIP postcards, and HIP comics. Now, you can sell other things like HIP comics. You can sell pretty much any non-sports trade card. Now, again, I do have an affiliate link. I would get a commission, possibly, if you use that link. No cost to you, but I've got some links that will give you 3 free months on those platforms. It's right down there in the description box. So if you want it, again, it's an affiliate link. I could get a commission. I'm not paid to say that, though. So I still have used HIP Platform for a year and a half. I sell a lot of stuff on HIP Platform, more so than I have on pretty much any of the other platforms in the paper and vintage collectibles. In fact, there's another postcard guy who just signed up for it. The next day, he sent me a notice saying he already sold 2 items on the platform. I've had a lot of people tell me they've sold a bunch of stuff on HIP Postcard right after they listed it. To list it on like a platform like that, you're clicking a few buttons, and it's auto-imported for free into HIP. And it ends your item on eBay and puts the word sold in your listing, in your completed listing section, so you can't resell it. It's almost impossible. It actually puts a different word in the front, so you can't miss it. And if you did miss it, all you got to do is look in your store and type the word in sold, and it's going to show up because it's in the title. So anyway, there's a lot of stuff people can do, you know. Depends on what you sell, though, Donald's Discoveries. Seattle comfortable 80s. Yeah, I've been there when it's been cooler. Jackass Retro, how are you doing? Bremerton. My summer sales is gravy to what I get from October, March. October, March, yeah, we do very well, but I don't have that die-off. If I have a die-off, it's usually my own fault for not listing something or just being lazy, would be all honesty. My little apartment is stuffed with items. I can't stop buying things when I go out sourcing. Catherine Sampson. If you're just buying a bunch of stuff, though, keep in mind that you're just sitting stuff there that you have money tied up into. I would rather buy a bunch of stuff and then just spend my time to get it all up, so at least I have the revenue coming back in. Some people have bought themselves out of business by not listing it enough or quick enough. And then when they realize they were in trouble, they couldn't get enough stuff listed quick enough to get enough money coming in to even pay their bills. I'm not saying that's you. I'm just giving everybody else that advice out there. Be careful. I've got a ton of inventory. I don't need to source. I could probably go a couple of years, maybe even more than that. And I'm not exaggerating. I could probably go a few years with the quantity without touching a single solitary thing. Could probably go 5 or 10 years without buying anything else, depending on how the markets go. But I have it all paid for. As crazy as that sounds, all this stuff is paid for. I'll pull out a high-dollar item from every lot I get, sell it, get my money back, get a little profit, sell some more stuff, and then if it sits there for a little while, I'm not worried. I get bored, you know, pricing certain items, and I'll move from one category to another quite often. It keeps things new and fresh. Button-wise, I could probably do buttons every day of my life. You know, I don't mind doing that, but anyway, a lot of money in buttons, thousands a week in buttons. It's just a lot of money. Jackass Retro, never count in summer sales and just use the time to buy and list for the dark months. Exactly. That would be a good thought. You can get your summer months up, though. It's not a non-doable thing. If you're selling in collectible fields, you do very well with that if you're in collectibles. In the summer months, people collect all year round. If an issue they've been wanting for months shows up in the summer and it's top dollar, they're still going to buy it, you know? And with collectors, even if they'll put a few bucks aside to save up for a specific comic, a specific toy, or a coin, or a stamp, or a postcard, or any of that kind of stuff. Items that would be banned because of the content of the items in general, or anything like that. So, you know, you've got to take all those things into account on what you sell. Far too many people are taking an easier route. I'm not criticizing, that's not meant as like a crack, but if you take the easy route and you're not learning stuff, you're just going and getting what everybody else is doing, you're not going to have as big of an opportunity to get the top bucks for stuff. Why do I get more money than other people on stuff that other people can find? Because I've spent the time, I know the information that's going to get me the top dollar. I know how to identify it correctly, how to price it correctly. I don't worry about what other people are doing. I don't race to the bottom of it. I did a video on sending offers to watchers, and somebody says, well, you're just giving away money. I price my stuff higher intentionally because of perceived value. If you, you know, can't afford to give a small discount to drum up a little more business, I have people that tell me, oh, I raise the price if I get a bunch of watchers. If your item has watcher, like 10 watchers, and it has 10 watchers for 9 months, and no one's done an offer, it's priced too high. Raising the price isn't going to do it these days. Those days, I used to do that. If something didn't sell 5 or 10 years ago, you could raise the price, and people would, for some reason, think it's a better deal. It doesn't work like that for us anymore. I don't find that. I just price it high to start with. I'll do an offer. I'll do a small discount or a specific discount, and then still send an offer to watcher. And I'm still taking in, even doing that, more than probably 95% of the people selling the exact same items as me. I don't care what somebody else sells something for. I care what I sell it for. I get constantly a buyer will say, well, I can get this right now for such and such. I says, well, then I would recommend, if that's what you're saying, to probably do it, because I'm not going to do that. Obviously, I'll say it very nicely, but I get that. And what happens is, at the end of the day, probably the majority of those people, 75%, will buy it from me either way, even though they said they would never do it. Again, you've got to know the market. You've got to know your items, why they're worth more than other people's. You've got to ID them. You've got to know more about them. If you don't take the time in, you're going to be stuck selling the same pair of jeans that everybody else has, the same this, the same that. Giving up clothing was the best thing I ever did. I'll tell you straight out, that was the best thing I ever did for space, for sanity, for returns, for scammers, for people renting clothing and then sending it back at the last day of after a month of wearing it, damaging it, ripping it, not wearing it and getting them dirty and not washing them before sending them back. All that stuff, everybody out there who sells that kind of thing knows. I don't have any of that. I don't have return rates like that, hardly ever. There are items that are returned. If they are, it's a legitimate one 99% of the time. I can just resell it. No big deal. I do free returns, and I still don't have any of that stuff going on. It just doesn't happen. You know, it comes down to what you're selling. If you're not willing to invest the time to learn more about something, you're always going to be skunked out by someone like me. You're always going to be skunked out if you're not investing the time. I walk behind people every day if I'm outsourcing or something that are supposed to be topping their notch, and I can pull stuff out that they walked right by because they only know the common stuff that everybody else knows. That's it. And they don't have the eye for certain things, or they don't realize certain things are worth money. It's not a brag. There's a ton of sellers just like me who've come to this exact same conclusion that you got to buckle down, whether it's RA, whether it's books, whether it's video games. You got to know something more than everybody else. It's the only way. Most everything I sell for top dollar again because I know more about it than everybody else. There's very few people in certain categories I sell in that can top me. There's a guy who writes the book in one of the categories. He actually buys from me. I copy off some of the things he does because it works for him. There's many things like that. Where are we at? Sales down 30%. This is Catherine Sampson, but I don't do eBay for a living, just for cash for savings. 30%, that's not a good downage right there. But again, it depends on what you need out of eBay. Sales have been dramatically dropped in the last 2 weeks. Metal for Gemini. Exactly what I'm telling you. My predictions are it's going to be much worse than any time before in history for a summer slowdown. Because of the pandemic and because of everything opening all up at once, everybody had been stuck in. Everybody's got, you know, their cabin fever, you know. And I think that's going to play a big part in why people aren't going to be buying as much offline. It's not a reason to panic. I am sure once the season starts to cool down and we go back in, you'll have flu season coming up. There'll be more people worried. I think more sales will pick up again in the winter, and it'll be a little busier than last winter, in my opinion. But summer's going to be awful, I think, for a lot of people that didn't invest the time to learn different items. That's all I can tell you. Sassy Squirrel Stash, my sales were down 43% last week, but up a little bit this week, but still down by 24%. This is the start of it. The 4th of July weekend will be slow. I can almost guarantee you that based on the last 11 plus years of our sales. Again, I know I could be down a hair. I'm not too worried about it. I'll just list a few extra things and then move on from there. I could list one poster that's worth $1,000 and make up any loss I would have. You know, it's a vintage beer poster. I've been waiting. I'm saving it for that week just for that reason. Just in case. Naomi, yeah, we had someone mention to us that we had a counterfeit toy Ninja Turtle. We trusted him and threw that toy out. He said all of our Ninja Turtles, other Ninja Turtles were okay. I would not throw out a counterfeit vintage Ninja Turtle because it could be a foreign one, or some of the knockoffs are worth money too. I never discard anything, even if it's not a legit pressing. Bootlegs sell just as well, if not better. So, word to the wise, next time I would get somebody else to look at it and make sure, just because someone tells you that, it may be some from some other line and they may not know that. Whenever somebody tells me that, I never go by their saying on it. NH guy, he says he's steady with the sales. I'm not listening to what you've been saying for a long time. I just diversified my store. I stock collectibles, antiques, obscure items that you just can't get every day. What a world of difference. This is Joe, the Breadman Reseller Channel. He has a difference in sales from selling different items. It's a rat race going to garage sales around here. If someone's showed up, if it's a well-advertised garage sale around here, someone shows up the night before and acts stupid and says, oh, I didn't know. I thought it was today. I've heard that a dozen times a year or more ago when we were going to garage sales. The same thing goes for estate sales. Mysteriously, the same couple, the same people show up. They're big-time dealers. They lie and they say, oh, I thought it was today. I heard it so many times from people constantly over and over again. So there's nobody's playing fair around here. Everybody wants to scam you out or get to it before you. I've seen it all. It's a rat race. Selling the stuff I do, I don't ever have to worry about any of that crap. Pardon me, but that's what it's turned into these days. I'm not a cutthroat. Even if I'm out there buying stuff, you see I leave stuff on the table that I could make money off of. I don't have to have everything. I'm selective because I can afford to. I don't need to buy stuff I don't care to sell. In almost every video I'm out there, I've passed off stuff because it just didn't interest me. Some of it maybe because, again, as I'm telling you, certain things are better to sell than others. In every category you can go down and figure that out too. Semperfi 1918, my sales are up and down, a sale of two every few days, but I'm in the 200 listing zone right now and growing. 1,500 in sales in the last 90 days. Good to go. Jackass Retro, October's pay is the best thing you can do. Well, thank you very kindly. Catherine Sampson, gorgeous, 70 degrees in suburban Boston. Boston's usually cooler, especially with it being on the water right there. I've flown into Logan so many times, and you can always tell because the temperatures usually change, and the clouds are usually low in season in Boston. So last time we flew into Logan, we flew in, and we came out of the clouds like right above the ground, and it was a totally different hemisphere weather-wise. Where are we at? Nitix, I'm about to shut down the store for 2 months, not a full-timer, and still have kids in school. Everybody's, you got to do what you got to do. Family first, always, 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 always. Our sales are down. This is Amazon Seller 99, about 20% this week, but that's pretty standard for this week before Prime Day. I don't have the issues. Nothing I sell would be affected by a Prime Day either. I never worry about Prime Day. Even NOS, RA, and FBA stuff, it's all stuff that sells year round, the stuff that we do. I've got three items that I've had for what we're going on like more than five years, I want to say, that I've had the only listings for those on Amazon. That's why I don't give out my Amazon accounts either, because those items have made us a lot of money religiously over and over and over and over and over and over and over again. I have no competition. That's almost impossible to find these days. James Nichols, well, thank you. Good evening to you as well. I know where Wakefield's at. Pamela Saban, I have terrible sales in week ends, but better during the week, but been fixing all my listings, title, price, specs, went through and did an inventory. Yeah, we've been going through, and I've said this before, we've been going through and updating old photos, pulling them up and rescanning everything. We never had a scanner when we first started off. We were photoing everything. And now with a duplex scanner, yes, I use a DS510. Anything above DS510 series, 610, 620, 640, any of those up or higher are good, as long as it's the Epsons. I've used a couple of them. We actually have two of the DS510 duplex scanners. I can scan both sides of like 40 plus postcards in a minute with that scanner. I think it's even probably more. It's a lot. It's a lot, depending on the DPI you do. And, you know, so it's not as big of a hassle as you would think fixing photos, as long as they're scannable. And I would recommend everybody going back through and fixing your photos, checking your titles. When I look at people's stores and do store reviews and stuff for them and Patreon and stuff, pretty much there's maybe been one that didn't have any issues like this, but pretty much every store I look at, if you just changed a few words or added a word into a title, those items would sell. And I've pointed things out, and most of the time, the vast majority of time, they get some items sold when they change those titles up with those words they're missing. Or the order of the words matters. Don't put stuff, like if I'm listing a postcard, I don't put the word postcard in the front. The most important stuff has to be the left of your listing, so it shows up on the phone's limited amount of space. A lot of people don't like to look at more. They don't want to tap to expand the listing or tap to enter into the listing unless they're interested in it to begin with. So you have to have all your stuff, all your important words, at the far left of all your listings. It's another one of those things that you need to worry about. Hang on, where am I at? Professor, what's your advice for bottom line sales for a second year seller? Feels like anything priced below $20 is a waste of time. I can't tell you what would be good for anybody specifically. We have a $9.99 because if the item's $9.99, most of the stuff that I have you can list in like a minute per listing on average. Maybe a minute and a half if it's something that takes a little longer. And that's no exaggeration. Style's similar. The only thing we change is the two photos, a price, and a title. We list like-to-like items right one after another, so all you got to do is style similar. You're only changing a few things. It's very quick. I've got videos on here showing me listing 20-plus items in like 20 minutes. So 40-plus items in an hour is a very doable if you're not selling clothing or stuff that needs tons of photos and tons of elaborate details or condition statements. Again, most of what I sell, the condition can be determined by the duplex scanner or my flatbed scanned image. And I usually have a generic description. I state, like for my dust jackets, it may have rips, tears, or other issues to it. And that's the description for every one of that type of item. So I don't have to worry about going back in. If there's something very specific wrong with it, I'll just type in and little add one little note to the end of the description box for that. If I'm going down in $9.99, I have to be able to list those items quickly. If Crystal, you want to list items for say $20, or if you want to be able to do $10 items, you've got to be able to list enough of them an hour to get your hour's worth of return on it. For every hour that I work, I have a set amount of money that I need to make for that hour. It's into the hundreds of dollars per hour is what I earn when I'm doing my eBay business or reselling in general, whether it's Amazon or not. That's what I want to get out of my time. I've got to get a certain amount of money out of my time. And if it takes me 20 minutes to list one item, I don't want to sell it. So think about that when you're out there sourcing. Do you think about the fact that if you're doing clothing, you've got to get a mannequin out. You've got to worry about photographing it and white backgrounds and removing the back. There's a lot of stuff you got to do to it. again, I like clothing. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it, but take that into consideration. So if you're selling clothing and you only list 3 or 4 an hour, 5 an hour, 10 an hour, I don't know how many can somebody list, you probably want to do a $20 per item. Again, my hour value wise, my amount I want to earn for every hour I work is going to be higher than a lot of people, because I've got overhead, I've got employees, I've got a ton of revenue, I've got a ton of building expenses and things like that too that we have to worry about also. So I'm in a different boat than everybody else, but I cut it off. It used to be $7.99. We raised it to $9.99. Again, these are the $9.99 items that I list are ones that I can list a lot of in that same time frame. They're not something that I can only get a couple up. I mean, it's not practical. That's, again, why I cut off clothing. Records takes a little more time. So if I'm going to list a record, it's either going to be a cheap record on Discogs where I don't have to take a picture, or it's going to be a better record on eBay that I can also cross-list to Amazon. So that's my take on it. I wish I'd give you a better answer on that, Crystal. I don't want to give you bad information. It's going to come down to what you're selling, how long it takes you to list it. My listing prices, what I'll go down, again, as I said, is based on how many I can get listed in an hour, how much money I can get up in that hour. I shoot for, you know, $500 usually per hour for most employees to get stuff up. That's always my goal. Obviously, I don't meet it every time, but get a goal of how much stuff you need to list. I'm talking about list price on eBay. $500 per hour is a good number to shoot for of merchandise. And if you're selling clothing, it might be doable with 2 or 3 pieces of clothing. But you've got to take into account that those 2 or 3 pieces of clothing, if they're not hot items, they sell seldom. It may take you a long time to get that money back on them. I would rather list 40 items that are $9.99 that I'm going to get my money back on, rather than 3 items that may make up that same amount of time or same amount of money, because I have a far better chance of getting a quicker return, at least money coming back from listing more items than less. You got more opportunities. So, I mean, that's just my take on it. Sassy Squirrel Stash. I found recently that some of the specs I had in my listings were completely disappearing. I had to go back in to quite a few of my listings, put the specs in again. Item specifics, yes, I filled them in for records, and I had to go right back in and do them again 2 weeks later. And that button that says don't ask again, they just show right back up. That means nothing, apparently. Naomi, yeah, I copy that, Jack. That's somebody else. It's been a lifesaver. Well, thank you very kindly. Diversifying, Jackass Retro, diversifying inventory is the key to stable sales. If it dips in one category, I've got other categories to make up the slack. That's the best I can tell you on that. You don't see me outsourcing. None of the people around here who probably would recognize me don't see me outsourcing, because I don't do it. It's not fictitious. I don't do the videos. I don't do it in person. I don't have to do it. Again, that should be your goal. Your goal should be able to just go to one place and buy 500 of something that you know you can sell. Wouldn't that be the best bet? Would you rather do that, even though it's fun, than just driving around to 10 garage sales a day and hoping to get something? It's a hope. It you never know. Who could have beaten you to that garage sale, even if the pictures are so great? It's just, all of that is risky around here, and I can't rely on something. I don't want to do it because I've got a family. I got bills and stuff to pay. If I can't rely on it or can't count on it on a regular routine basis, I look elsewhere. I try to figure out what's best. You know, bulk purchase is always the best. Diversifying and having multiple items in multiple categories is best. I'm not saying you can't find some horrendously great category that you can replenish constantly that'll do you great and you'll never have to worry about anything else, but most people aren't going to be that lucky. That's like a 1 in a million shot, from in my opinion. I have 500 listings today, Energy Soup. I sell vintage wristwatches, vinyl records, and CDs. My last 3 months sales are 3,700 for the past 3 weeks. It's led to today's lowest traffic percent. I'm down 65% in traffic. Again, as I said, it's going to go down from here, I'm telling you. Records and CDs are going to be slow in the summer. I'll tell you right off the bat. If it's a high-dollar record, it's a collectible record, you won't have that issue. But if you're selling $10, $20 records, $10, $20 CDs, there are bunches of those. There's a lot of people doing them. Depends on where you're selling them at, too. I would have better luck selling a used CD on Amazon in vintage entertainment collectibles. That's where I would sell stuff like that or something along that line. Used CDs are fine. I don't mind selling those either. again, you've got to just be careful on what it is you're selling and where you're selling it as well, too. Let me see here where we at. Semperfy, my traffic went down 50%, but my click rate went from 0.4 to 0.9. So I don't worry about click-through rate, conversion rate, or anything else like that. I could care less about any of those numbers. I don't even look at that page on eBay, to be honest with you. It doesn't matter to me. I never look at my views. I don't care what my views are. I look at my sales. If my sales numbers are fine, I could care less about any conversion rate, click-through rate, sell-through rate, or anything else like that at all. I know the categories, the overall sell-through rate, and the categories I sell in. That's what matters in these categories. It's passive income. Until the right person comes along to see the majority of my items, it's not going to sell. And I'm fine with that because of the quantity. Everybody can't play this game unless you have the quantity. Quantity overrules pretty much all everything else in reselling, as long as you're careful on the type of items and that quantity you're getting. Having almost 30,000 items up in the store I share with you is enough to keep it going. Even if I didn't list a single thing, I could probably keep it rolling along just by changing a few titles, some images, and things like that. It's not quantity. Quantity outweighs the other aspects. So again, click-through rate means nothing to me. I'm not saying it won't mean anything to you. It depends on what you're selling. Again, everything is very specific to who you are and what you are selling. There's no other way around it. Catherine Sampson, I don't print a packing slip. It uses up so much ink on my small printer. I would suggest getting a laser printer or getting a Rollo or something like that. The thermal printers, if that's what you're only using the printer for. For me, I have a laser printer. I don't like having to switch default printers back and forth. I do two up sheets for... I got a Hewlett Packard. I can't remember the number. It's a WL series. I know that. It's laser. It's Wi-Fi. It's got everything you want on it. And it prints like 40 some odd pages a minute. So I print a lot of document size, 8.5 by 11 papers. And I hate having to switch between, default printers. So for me, I just print labels that way. I've got a Rollo around here too. I just don't use it anymore. I find it's just as practical and effective and price-wise for me just to use the laser printer and then print them on two-up sheets that I buy in mass bulk. And, I don't worry about it. I buy 5,000-10,000 at a time. Let's see where we're at here. Hey, Mike. Artie Mike in the house. How you doing? Again, I did put a video up today. I did answer everybody in Patreon as well, so you do have something to watch. Usually when I have extra footage for, like, you YouTube videos, I usually just discard them. I know people say, why don't you just post them? So from now on, you'll see them. They'll probably just be extra, so it won't count in the normal YouTube videos, but I'm putting them up on Patreon. So you've got more insider backstory stuff on the offers to watchers. I go in a bunch of detail there on those Patreon ones. It's not a super long one, but it's footage that I shot that I just didn't use. Signature, hello from Brazil. Well, welcome. 108 in Sacramento. Life is good, yeah. Depends on the temperature. At 108, that's pretty bad. Black Crystal Dice. Yes, please hit the like button. If you're not, I'm at 234 in house on my end. Cat Lom, hello, how are you doing? John Samard, life is good, haha, only 104 in Stockton. We're close to Lake Erie, so it usually has a lake effect, so it's not as bad here. Angels Don't Fall, 134 in Palm Springs, wow. Hey Don, Jennifer, how you doing, Jennifer? This may sound redundant, but I found a huge estate lot of vintage birthday cards. Would it be ridiculous to list them as a lot or one at a time? Depends on how old they are, I guess. Depends on what's on them and how graphic. Birthday cards aren't nearly as popular as Christmas, Halloween, Valentine's. Birthday cards are one of the least. If they're 30s cards and they've got some Art Deco or something else like that, and you don't want to list them because it would take you some time because they are birthday, I would probably list them, say, like in lots of like 8 or something like that, or maybe lots of 6 for a reasonable amount, so you can do front and back or something like that. That'll give you a front and back of 6 cards, or just do fronts of say 8 or 10, 12 cards and list them in lots that way. Maybe do one group shot and maybe do 11 cards or something. That's probably what I would do. Again, I, without seeing them, that would be my best recommendation. If they're Christmas cards, it's a little different story. You'll probably 10 times better sell a Christmas or Halloween or Valentine's card over a birthday card, in my opinion. Melanie Kimball, when do you put out Halloween? All year round. That's my honest opinion on Halloween. Now Halloween, like newer Halloween, my dog's down here. Now like newer Halloween costumes, something that somebody's gonna actually wear, not vintage or something like that. Usually have them up at least 2 months ahead of time if you're doing those. The just a random Halloween like leftover overstock from like last year, they're not gonna sell very well. Except around Halloween time itself, 2 months out or so at least. But if it's like a vintage postcard, vintage Halloween decorations, or any of that stuff, I list it all year round. I can sell a Halloween postcard for top dollar any time day, of the year. It doesn't matter. So it just depends on what the item is specifically. Let's see where we at. Oh, you're from Dayton. We go now. I've been on the Wright-Patterson quite a few times. CDs that you sell, are they new or sealed? Yeah, current ones on CDs. Yeah, you've got to have a mix on CDs, too, to do the best. I can tell you for sure. I picked up boxes of CDs from the dump, probably 1,000 plus or so. You can't beat them if they're free. See, people still assume that CDs don't carry a massive value, but you can list them on Discogs for free. You don't have to have a picture, so if they're $3 CDs, you can set a minimum requirement of, say, they got to buy $10 worth for you even to ship the order out. So you're at least going to get a $10 sale every day if somebody's buying something. So you can afford to, you can list on Discogs and, geez, a minute, literally no exaggeration on pretty much anything once you've done it a little while, because it's so simple. And if you know what you're looking for, it's really easy to pick out the version of the record you have. If you're selling single 45s, it's super, super easy. CDs, same thing. And you can sell all of that on Discogs. Rebecca Reed, how are you doing? Welcome back to you, too. I got InkFrog and Shopify, and I still have not gotten one sale yet off of Shopify. Is there something else I need to do besides put my pictures in catalog? Have you shared them with Chrome and Shopping, which is free through Shopify users? Those are your best bet options to do it. They're not going to advertise for you. So if you have a Shopify, you need to push it as well. That's my best guess. You need to make sure that you're showing your items through Google as well, too. Best way to do it. Have it all done that way. You need to be calling attention to your store as well. If you're sending stuff out from other platforms, you can always put in a thank you for shopping with a name and your information in there. That's what you need to do. Shopify is not like a platform that advertises or has a specific draw. You are your own entity. You're not technically like part of Shopify, so to speak. Shopify is the facilitator for your website, basically. So you've got to do the drum up and bring the overall business into your store when you're doing Shopify. That's the take on that one. InkFrog is just the bridge. InkFrog is not going to get you the any sales, really. InkFrog is just a bridge and a backup for your listings. For me, it's worth the $30 to have it, though. MW, hello, everyone. Does anyone send offers when you're on vacation, when your store has 7 to 10 days shipping? For us, somebody's usually here. I don't think I've shut down my business in like 8-10 years. Somebody else deals with it, when we're gone. I know everybody can't do that. I don't like doing the changing on the time, because usually if I see something, if we're buying something and it says it's not even going to ship for 10 days, I usually just look somewhere else. That's just my personal opinion. A lot of people don't want to wait, and I think changing the shipping time would hurt you. You're still not going to make many sales, hardly at all, in those cases. Yeah, and the only thing I would say, too, if you're sending the offer out, to somebody when you're on vacation and it may not be shipped out for 10 days, they may not see that. So if they may just look at the price and then wonder what's going on, why it hasn't been shipped out, they may not see that. So that would be another concern, I would say. I've been reaching out. I've got plans with Shopify. There's ways to get things to work. Let's just put it that way with Shopify and things like that too. I'm not going to give out my secrets, but there are ways to get it. Let's see where we're at. Hang on just a second here. Our drive-in theater has been a swap meet flea market for years. One is in Yucca Valley, California, and the other is in Prescott Valley, Arizona. Lifetime of great, unbelievable finds. We've got one here that's an old drive-in, but I've bought out movie theaters. I've bought out drive-ins. The best part of the last movie theater I bought out wasn't the films. It was the 35mm slides that they used prior to, like in the 70s and 80s, showing scenes from movies. I got like $300 and $400 a slide for some of those from a movie theater. I got a huge, big, massive bin of these things. Catherine says, I work full-time trying to cultivate sourcing in my spare time. I can't wait to retire and can really ramp up reselling efforts. I sell both open and sealed. However, I don't mess with any CD that aren't that are scratched. I do. It's worth buying in bulk. Goodwill outlet is my go-to buy in bulk. I've also looked online Craigslist and Facebook Marketplace, yard sales. Mark B. Evening back at you. I gotta have your opinion on something. I have thousands of comic books, records, and other items, but I constantly have other items coming in that I am listing. List them all now or later. I would list everything you got if you're still don't have a steady source of income. I would just start listing anything you can get up, especially items that you can propagate to more than one platform. I'm not trying to push HIP, but I get quite a considerable amount from HIP considering the little bit of effort that you had to do to get it going. There's nothing to it. Again, I got the links down there. I'm not trying to push it. I do get a commission if you use those links and do a certain thing. Just because you use the link doesn't mean I get a commission. You've got to get a store. You've got to import or list a whole bunch of stuff. But I use the site. It's a good site. I have never, ever in my life promoted something that I haven't actually used or done. And I've been on HIP for a year and a half. If you've got comic books, you can double list them without doing anything other than listing them on eBay on HIP Comic Books. You know, you can sell some of them on Amazon if you'd prefer as well, but you'll have to get some other app or a third party or API or Shopify or something to do it. Now, for those, again, Shopify, let's go back to Shopify for 1 minute. You don't have to use Shopify to sell. You can just use Shopify for an invisible bridge so you can hook up your Amazon, your Etsy, your eBay, Walmart, or anything else to one central location so you can sync your inventory. You don't have to have a site. You don't have to worry about advertising for it. If you want the same items that you, say, just have on Amazon or just have on eBay, a Shopify will do that, and you don't have to use Shopify as a store website. You can turn it into a blog post and not even sell anything on it if you don't want to. You can hide all of your merchandise from the Shopify platform, so it only uses it for syncing. It's worth $60 a month. Yeah, my green screen's totally off today, but it's worth $60 a month to have the InkFrog Shopify link just to sync my items. The time it takes you, if you've manually listed items on two different platforms, to take them down when something sells, it's worth more than $60. So if you're wanting to sync stuff and hook up your Amazon, your eBay, and stuff like that, then have something that will take it down and adjust your inventory when something sells so you don't have to do it. That's what you can use Shopify for too. It doesn't have to, you can start off small. You can just use it for the bridge. You can just use it for the syncing option. It works perfectly fine to sync whatever you want to do with it. I'm going to let you all go in just a few minutes here. It's a little longer than I thought I was going to go. Goodwill sells in lots. We buy them up every chance we get. Naomi, around here, the closest Goodwill bulk place I can buy is over 3 hours one way. So I don't do that. I don't go to any thrift store anymore, hardly at all. It's just mostly a waste of my time in this state anyway. If you're buying old pictures that are only 20 or 30 years old, yeah, you can sell them. You just can't make copies of them. You can sell anything like that you want. You can sell an original anytime without worrying about somebody going after you. But you can't sell copies of them. Let's cut it off there because I think we're going off from there. Again, I appreciate everybody coming on. If you haven't hit the like button, we're still over 200 people in-house right now. Let me just get a few things right here. Again, I do have another video coming up tomorrow. It is already done. I do have another Patreon video coming up on Saturday. And you should see another video up on the other channel showing me how, or showing everybody how I do and print my postcards of my own artwork. It's something we've done for a very long time, and it's a pretty good moneymaker for us as well. It's very cheap. It's very reasonable to have postcards printed in decent quantity. It far beats trying to do them at your own house and all that kind of stuff. Is they're all cut, they're all uniform, they're delivered to your house and the whole works. And the turnaround time is incredibly good too. So you'll get to see how to do that in a video on that channel as well. So again, I hope everybody appreciates the show tonight. If you enjoyed it, please hit the thumbs up for me again. Hopefully everybody's doing well. Don't panic on sales, and don't panic on sales for the 4th of July week. It will be slow. It's a typical time when it is slow. So work ahead. List some extra stuff to compensate for any downages you may have. Think about some sales, maybe some coupons. Coupons will take you some time to build up enough going out. If you're sending them out, it's going to take 4 or 5 days for them probably to get the coupon. So keep those thoughts in mind as you do it. So anyway, I will let you go, and I hope you all have a good day.